Oh, yeah, here. Let's talk about the Patagonia founder.
Behind the world-renowned company, famous for outdoor clothing and gear, is 83-year-old Yvon Chouinard, a climber, surfer, and lifelong environmentalist who just gave away his estimated $3 billion business, born from blacksmithing in a shed. His family transferred ownership of Patagonia to a trust and nonprofit organization created to funnel all of the apparel company's profits to fight climate change and defend nature. Instead of going public, you could say we're going purpose, Chouinard wrote in a public letter. Instead of extracting value from nature and transforming it into wealth for investors, we'll use the wealth Patagonia creates to protect the source of all wealth. The reluctant billionaire has never been swayed by business norms, even encouraging consumers to limit their spending at his company.
You know, you've heard of recycle and reuse, stuff like that. You also have to consider refuse. Refuse to buy something just because, you know, if you don't need it, don't buy it.
For decades.
Would have been a lot better if you gave the company to the workers. Yeah, certainly. Adam Conover, guess what? Billionaire who donated Patagonia to fight climate change will get a $700 million tax break, still control the company, spend the donated dollars to influence U.S. politics. Billionaire philanthropy is a scam. Tax the fucking rich. A truly charitable donation would have been to donate Patagonia or its proceeds to a nonprofit already working in the space, or hell, donate the dollars directly to those in need via GiveDirectly. Instead, he donated it to himself to spend as he sees fit. That's not charity. So, the system itself is designed in this way. That's not what the New York Times piece I saw said. I said he wouldn't get any tax benefit and give up all ownership. So here's what I'm going to say. No, people think that this is immediately like a Bill Gates style scam. There is a difference. And I don't think Adam Conover is correct on this. I hate to say it. Okay. There's a difference between taking your company and reforming it so that like all of the profits are direct donations, which I think is what he's doing. He'll probably still get paid a tight bag, right, for surviving in the way that he wants to live. But there's a difference between that and like doing what Mark Zuckerberg and Bill Gates have done, which is to set up a nonprofit basically to shelter all of their assets within that nonprofit. I don't think he's getting any income from it going forward. His kids still work for the company though. Yeah. I'm pretty sure he's not getting paid by the company at all anymore, but yes, he has enough money to not have to worry about money. Yeah, but I think he's doing like a... No, I do think that this is a decent fucking thing that he did. This is not like... This doesn't strike me as, I can't believe I'm saying this, but this is one of those very unique instances where it doesn't seem like he's doing this for immediate benefits. Like, there's always going to be some benefits, and he definitely is still, you know, he still made the bag for many, many years, right? But as far as, like, billionaires goes, and the system itself should not rely on billionaires being magnanimous. I've said this so many fucking times. This is a fundamental plank of my idea and the way I see the world, right? The system itself should not only be the system itself should not have such concentration of wealth and power at the top that the only time when someone is like, you know, the only time when good things are happening is when rich people have allowed it to happen, right? Like I myself do what is right all the time as well. I try to do what's right all the fucking time. But that does not change the reality that, you know, it should be like that. I talked about this with Andrew Schultz a lot as well. It should not be reliant on rich people behaving in the appropriate way, because the overwhelming majority of rich people, especially ones that get to that level of wealth, are not getting there by behaving in the right way. Rich people shouldn't be rewarded for just doing the right thing. No, you're misunderstanding it. I'm not even talking about this from just like automatic disdain. Automatic disdain for the rich. I'm saying that the system is fundamentally flawed because it relies on rich people individually deciding on their own to do the right thing. Okay? Especially because so many people that get to that level of wealth are doing it by not doing the right thing. The Patagonia heiress today. Well, my grandpa gave my inheritance to Greenpeace. Yeah. I think even his children are like pretty fucking woke though. A half a century after founding the outdoor pearl maker Patagonia, Yvon Chouinard, the eccentric rock climber who became a reluctant billionaire with his unconventional spin on capitalism, has given the company away. Rather than selling the company or taking it public, Mr. Chouinard, his wife and two adult children have transferred their ownership of Patagonia, valued at $3 billion, to a specially designed trust and a nonprofit organization. They were created to preserve the company's independence and ensure that all of its profits, some $100 million a year, are used to combat climate change and protect undeveloped land around the globe. The unusual move comes at the moment of growing scrutiny for billionaires and corporations whose rhetoric about making the world a better place is often overshadowed by their contributions to the very problems they claim to want to solve. At the same time, Mr. Chouinard's relinquishment of the family fortune is in keeping with his longstanding disregard for business norms and his lifelong love for the environment. Hopefully this will influence a new form of capitalism that doesn't end up with a very few rich people and a bunch of poor people, Mr. Chouinard, 83. Yeah, dude, why? Motherfuckers cannot see the world. Even when you do something that is like unthinkable as like a rich billionaire, his framework is still within the operation, the operations of capitalism. He's like, oh, let's just look at a different kind of capitalism. How about no capitalism? There is a different kind of capitalism. It's called not capitalism. It's called socialism. I'm just saying, it'd be kind of cool to think about it that way. We are going to give away the maximum amount of money to people who are actively working on saving this planet. Patagonia will continue to operate as a private for-profit corporation based in Ventura, California, selling more than $1 billion worth of jackets, hats, and ski pants each year. But the Chouinards, who control Patagonia until last month, no longer own the company. In August, the family irrevocably transferred all the company's voting stock, equivalent to 2% of overall shares, into a newly established entity known as the Patagonia Purpose Trust. The trust, which will be overseen by members of the family and their closest advisors, is intended to ensure that Patagonia makes good on its commitment to run a socially responsible business and give away its profits. Because the Chouinards donated their shares to a trust, the family will pay about $17.5 million in taxes on the gift. The Chouinards then donated the other 98% of Patagonia, its common shares, to a newly established nonprofit organization. Bro, how do you expect a billionaire to be anti-capitalist, Naive Hassan? I mean, what he's doing in this circumstance, if he's doing it appropriately and not like a Bill Gates, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation style asset sheltering, basically, is technically, you know, doing something that is liquidating all of your fucking capital and giving it to other causes instead, which will not be the recipient of all the company's profits and use funds to combat climate change. Because the Holdfast Collective is a 501c4, which allows it to make unlimited political contributions, the family received no tax benefit for its donation. Like, under the narrow framework of capitalism, you're not going to get anything better than that. And a billionaire itself is probably only going to a billionaire themselves, or who have generated billions of dollars in revenue, are only going to get to that point through exploitation, through a series of exploitative practices. It might still be good, okay? It might still be better than like 99% of corporations. Acting like compassionate capitalism is not possible is irrational. Acting like it will become the norm is equally so. Quite literally, the point of capitalism is for the wealthiest individuals to make money off the poorest and sacrificing all other standards. There's no such thing as ethical capitalism. Yeah, no, this is a perfect example, okay? Recognizing all profit is extracted from nature is honestly a huge step, something which is honestly very anti-capitalist on its own merit, yes. And not only that, doing it in this way where he's like relinquishing all of the wealth, especially because he's like, I already got the bag. This is it. You know what I mean? Didn't Gates and a bunch of billionaires commit to donating most of their wealth? Well, one can only see what they end up doing with this contribution.
What is going on here?
Okay. Not exactly, KB. Thank you for the 5. Get the subs. One nice billionaire doesn't make up for hundreds of evil ones. I agree. There was a meaningful cost to them doing it, but it was a cost they were willing to bear to ensure that this company stays true to their principles. A merchant bank that works with ultra-wealthy individuals, including Warren Buffett, and who helped Patagonia design their new structure, and they didn't get a charitable deduction for it. There is no tax benefit here whatsoever. Yeah. But of course, leftists are doing the one thing that we always love doing, which is like, here's a guy who's like doing something that's a little bit different. Here's a guy who's doing at least a little bit, something that's a little bit different than like what billionaires at their status normally don't even fucking think about doing and defend it. And you're like, we should kill this one first. Okay, kill him. I don't know what to tell you. Like, it's just like, this doesn't change the system itself. Billionaires across the board are a policy failure. He himself is already recognizing that, it seems like. You know what I mean? Like, this is what other motherfuckers do. Bear Sade, the Republican donor, okay? Who literally took his company, turned it into a 501c4, and dumped it into the Federalist Society. Meanwhile, this motherfucker is doing it. This motherfucker is doing it for conservation efforts, something that he's like personally cared about his entire life. And you're like, nah, it's not enough. Fuck this guy. It's just overall, it seems like an overall good thing, okay? Patagonia also doesn't seem to use sweatshops and have a low turnover rate in employees, so at least compared to other billionaires, he seems good. You have changed. Hassan says, respect the reluctant billionaire. Publish this. Whoopsie, I came a billionaire. I exploited my workers. Whoops. No, I recognize all of that. But I also recognize, here's what I recognize, okay? I recognize that at the top of the hour, there's a 6-second ad break. And if you no longer want to see those ads, well, then all you need to do is subscribe, which you can do for $5 or for free with a Twitch Prime by connecting your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account where you get one free Prime subscription a month. Okay, use it on your favorite streamer. Hopefully that's me. I also recognize that you can get gifted a sub if you no longer want to see those ads. If you get lucky, you can get gifted a sub. Here's a woman ad break now. Dude, what is with you today? He did what he did. No billionaire can get to that level of wealth without a profound amount of exploitation. That's just the truth. Okay, that is the system that we exist under, and if someone within that framework, someone who has achieved a profound amount of success by taking advantage of that system, decides to change their own personal outlook on it and literally do something that many other people would not choose to do, and no one in his level of wealth has done. Okay. And that's why you're probably seeing like That's why you're seeing the Bloombergs of the world. Do they not want them to fight climate change? No, I just... Leftist always got to be the kid in class who raises his hands and corrects every little thing. Good thing that he did that. The people need to shut the fuck up. Did you already talk about the railroad strike? Yes, I did. I know, knowing I get billed to clients at $80 an hour and only get paid $27 an hour has recently radicalized my already radical socialist beliefs. Yeah, I mean. By giving away the bulk of their asses during their lifetime, the Chouinards, Yvonne, his wife Melinda, and their two children, Fletcher and Claire, who are both in their 40s, have established themselves among the most charitable families in the country. This family is a way outlier when you consider that most billionaires give only a tiny fraction of their net worth away every year. Even those who have signed... And by the way, again, charitable donations do not fix the problem, okay? Charitable donations and billionaires doing charity does not actually fucking fix the problem itself. Obviously. And I hope that you're not thinking that I'm making that argument in any capacity, because that is not correct. But as far as like working within the framework, instead of like drastically working to undermine the current pre-existing hierarchies of exploitative capitalist practices, which is the best thing you can do, right? Like, it would be better if he gave away... It would be... Here's what would have been better from a leftist perspective. If he actually engaged in profit sharing with his workers, allowed it to run, maybe not as a cooperative, but at least like with some workers' council or some unionization, that then down to the fucking very smallest, like first level, entry level employee, had some say in what the philanthropy operates as, right? Then that would be better, okay? That would have been a better way to do this. And then those people might have even voted to, yes, still take all of those take all those profits and turn them directly into turn all those profits into combating climate change. So obviously, the fact that he did this as an individual decision by himself is a byproduct of the system. It's not necessarily his individual fault. He did have the capacity to be more magnanimous, right, than he is currently. He exploited his workers, built massive wealth, and gets to jerk off in his charitable fame now. From a leftist perspective, of course he'll get hate. Yes. I'm already telling you exactly how he could have structured his business. He was not a capitalist himself. But of course a fucking billionaire is going to still be capitalist. They're a fucking billionaire. I'm recognizing that and then telling you that this is the best it's going to get within the same fucking narrow framework. He is literally a billionaire. I don't know why you are... The irony of a leftist taking the reactionary view. I mean, I'm not. I don't think I'm taking a reactionary view here. Wait, what? Chatters are doing the same thing that they always do, where they are jumping down the throat of someone who is marginally better than others in this situation. Don't do that. Okay? Now, what can happen in this situation, definitely didn't have Hassan defending a billionaire on my Twitch bingo. I'm not defending him. What I'm simply stating is, if this 501c4 works in the way that he promised that it would, and I have no reason to suspect that it won't, considering like how much he seemingly cares about this sort of thing and what some of the words he has mentioned are, okay? Unless he's just using this as a tax shelter so that he just dumps all the funds back into his own pockets, pays himself out like insane non-taxable funds, okay? Bro, Hassan, you gotta stop defending this guy. Okay, I'm gonna start banning people. I think they're doing it. I think these people are doing it on purpose. I'm not gonna yell. Even those who have signed the giving pledge don't give away that much and tend to get richer every year, Mr. Callahan added, referring to the commitment by hundreds of billionaires to give away the bulk of their fortunes. Patagonia has already donated $50 million to the Holdfast Collective and expects to contribute another $100 million this year. Mr. Mosley said the story was unlike any other he had seen in my career in my 30 years of estate planning. What the Chouinard family has done is really remarkable. It's irrevocably committed. They can't take it back out again, and they don't want to take it back out again. For Mr. Chouinard, it was even simpler than that, providing a satisfactory resolution to the matter of succession planning. I didn't know what to do with the company because I didn't ever want a company, he said, from his home in Jackson, Wyoming. I didn't want to be a businessman. Now I could die tomorrow and the company is going to continue doing the right thing for the next 50 years and I don't have to think about it or be around it. They literally had to invent new ways to give away money for this shit. The company has given away 1% of its sales for decades, mostly to grassroots environmental activists, and in recent years, the company has become more politically active, going so far as to sue the Trump administration in a bid to protect the Bears Ears National Monument. It is Patagonia's sales soared. Mr. Chouinard's own net worth continued to climb, creating an uncomfortable conundrum for an outsider who abhors excessive wealth. I was in the Forbes magazine listed as a billionaire, which really, really pissed me off, he said. I don't have $1 billion in the bank. I don't drive Lexuses. The Forbes ranking and then the COVID-19 pandemic helped set in motion that a process that would unfold over the past 2 years and ultimately led to Chouinard's giving away the company. Yeah, he didn't even bring up a Bugatti. What a broke boy. The problem is that even though that the write-up is New York Times is glowing, the fact that he set up a trust structure means that his family will remain in control of the company for perpetuity. Sure, it's better than other billionaires, but it's still a tax scam. The easiest path, selling the company or taking it public, would have given Mr. Chouinard ample financial resources to fund conservation initiatives. That was the strategy pursued by his best friend, Doug Tompkins, founder of the clothing companies East Spirit and The North Face. But Mr. Chouinard had no faith that Patagonia would be able to prioritize things like worker well-being and funding climate action as a public company. Because then you would have a fiduciary responsibility to your shareholders and you would have to set up a board of executives that would quite literally work to increase profits endlessly. And that would, of course, always mean reduce benefits as best as possible and exploit your workers further. I don't respect the stock market at all, he said. Once you're public, you've lost control over the company and you have to maximize profits for the shareholder and then you become one of those irresponsible companies. They also considered simply leaving the company to Fletcher and Claire, but even that option didn't work because the children didn't want the company. It was important to them that they were not seen as financial beneficiaries. They felt very strongly about it. I know it can sound flippant, but they really embody this notion that every billionaire is a policy failure. Finally, the legal team and board members landed on a solution. In December, at a day-long meeting in the hills above Ventura, the entire team came together for the first time since the pandemic began. Meeting outside, they agreed to move ahead. We still had a million and one other things to figure out, but it started to feel like this might actually work. Now that the future of Patagonia's ownership is clear, the company will have to make good on its lofty ambitions to simultaneously run a profitable corporation while tackling climate change. Some experts caution that without the Chouinard family having a financial stake in Patagonia, the company and the related entities could lose their focus. While the children... That's so funny. I don't get why we should tax the rich more, and also this guy's not so bad or hard thoughts for people to hold I don't know. How could he make the business successful if there's no financial incentive anymore after a whole article about a guy who made a $3 billion company despite not caring about money? I swear my grandfather was a union organizer in Ventura, was good friends with Chouinard, and he definitely taught him and left his politics, even if he is a billionaire. While the children remain on Patagonia's payroll and the elder Chouinards have enough to live comfortably on, the company will no longer be distributing any profits to the family. What makes capitalism so successful is that there is motivation to succeed, said Ted Clark, executive director of the Northeastern University Center for Family Business. If you take all financial incentives away, the family will have essentially no more interest in it except a longing for the good old days. Yeah. How can a company maintain its interest in profit seeking if those profits are not going directly into their pockets, but instead to a trust fund that will work to improve conservation efforts? I mean, isn't that the incentive? He cares about that more than anything else. As for how the Holdfast Collective will distribute Patagonia's profits, Mr. Chouinard said much of the focus will be on nature-based climate solutions, such as preserving wildlands. And as a 501c4, the Holdfast Collective will also be able to build on Patagonia's history of funding grassroots activists, but it could also lobby and donate for political campaigns. For the Chouinards, it resolves the question of what will happen to Patagonia after its founder is gone. Like, it's not great. The best thing to do is, like I said, set the company structure up in an entirely different way. If you don't care about the profits. If you don't care about the profits itself, the best way to eradicate profits is by allowing your workers to have a say in how it's distributed, right? But ultimately, I don't know. It being a 501c4 and not like a blind trust or something, or not even a blind trust, it just, I don't know. Questions that reporters should ask Patagonia. Chouinard has created a 401c4 entity, which 501c4, I thought, entity which enables them in small circle of family and advisors to spend $100 million a year in unrestricted funds on elections, lobbying campaigns in perpetuity. Holdfast Collective is the same category as Club for Growth, Americans for Prosperity, but guaranteed $100 million in spending a year. That's 2x, 4x what these groups are spending in 2022 elections. In the process, Chouinard not only avoids $700 billion in capital gains taxes from a sale of the company and estate taxes, but he plus his family, if they want to immediately leap off of Tom Steyer as the new financial kingmakers in the Democratic Party. It's easy to be blinded by Chouinard's good fight on climate action and land protection, but who elected him and a few other close advisors as a $100 million year political power broker on these issues? And now Chouinard and his friends not only will be interfering in U.S. elections, but will also use land use decisions from across the global south, all in the name of what he defines as the good fight. Okay. Again, the problem in this situation, the problem here revolves around, I mean, election interference is like kind of an interesting way to talk about it. It is true, right? No, he's not wrong. He's not wrong, except our scrutiny or our everything right now that people are feeling completely hinges on whether or not this dude is a good person or not. That's it. And guess what, guys? Sucks to suck, but unfortunately, in the system that we fucking currently exist under, this is the best we can get. That's simply what I was trying to say. And I was actually trying to make a larger point about how we should not rely on billionaires behaving in a magnanimous capacity for the system to fix itself. Okay? That's it. That's how this works. That's how it works. He didn't dodge taxes and run away with the bag. He avoided taxes because he didn't even get the bag. He just straight up donated the whole company. Yes. But as a 501c4, how much of those how much of the funds, which are all the fucking which are basically all of the profits that they would normally be receiving, how much of that can he use to fund his own lifestyle? Right? That's a question that I have. How much of that will he, what is that? No, no, I don't want it. I don't want it. No, get that away from me. Get that away from me. Bro, why are you trying to get me fat? No, get that away from me. No, take it away. You son of a bitch. Put that in the fridge and throw the chips out. No, throw the chips out. How much do you weigh right now? Okay, get the fuck, throw the chips out. I don't want to see them. I can't believe you did this. This motherfucker came in here. He's in, Murat and I have been duking it out. Okay. We've been battling and I've been beating him. But recently, for the past 2 weeks, especially when I went to New York and, you know, did all the shit that I've been doing, like shit camp and whatnot, he beat my ass. He's in the 240s now. I'm not. I went back up. I'm in like the 250s. So this son of a bitch goes in. I can't believe I'm calling my own mom a bitch here, but this son of a gun, okay, turns around and goes and buys me guacamole and chips, and he brought it and he dropped it right there. I was like, no, get out of here. I know what he's doing. He was laughing too. He's trying to get me fat. None, because he and his wife are not getting any more profits in the company per the article, only the kids who are still on a payroll, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I'm saying he still operates the trust, the 501c4. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's a 501c4, so it's like a pack. And a pack still has working people within it, within its structure. And if they're controlling exactly where the fucking pack goes and exactly where the spending goes, again, things that we don't know yet. He could technically fund his own pockets. He could technically take all of this and use it as his own personal slush fund. If he does that, he's not a good guy. But it doesn't seem like, looking at his like past actions and looking at what he has said so far, it doesn't seem like he's going to do that. I'm pretty sure he can use it for personal use, but the criticism is that they can decide exactly how their money is used, even if it's for a good cause, which they could be woefully misinformed about. That was the issue with Bill Gates and his interference with public education. That is absolutely correct. And that is a byproduct of the working system that we operate inside of. Do you understand? You get it? That was what I was saying. That is always going to be the unfortunate byproduct of operating within a capitalist system, okay? If you operate within a capitalist organization of the economy, yes, billionaires have all of the fucking power. I understand that. I totally understand that. And I'm simply stating that all of this hinges on him being good or bad. And it shouldn't be that way. That's why I don't advocate for ethical capitalism. Okay, that's why I advocate for a different organization of the economy. But it is kind of funny that so many motherfuckers in the chat who are like, why don't you use your wealth for good? Why don't you use your influence for good? Which I do, as many of you recognize. Okay, are now seeing someone at least say that they're doing that, and immediately their reaction is not fuck you. Okay? any like any of those neoliberal scrutinizers of myself who don't understand what I do with my money, if they dare criticize this person, I don't know what to tell you. I mean, I know for a fact it was a nice guy. That doesn't mean I trust him with $1 billion. Brother, I know that. I get that. But the way that the system works, unfortunately, is he gets to do whatever the fuck he wants with it. You get it? You understand? You're just priming us for when you donate the stream to a 501c3 to help labor organizers. Nice try. We see right through you. Yeah. Of course, this doesn't ultimately solve the problem because it's still within the framework of the problem itself. If you consider billionaires to be a policy failure like he has, like he's openly stated, then he has to understand that the policy needs to change. And that policy is economic policy. It's the economic organization of society.
He's given away 1% of Patagonia's annual sales to environmental causes.
For me, it's an earth tax. It's a tax, taxing ourselves for being polluters, for using up non-renewable resources.
But the climate advocate says that's no longer enough, writing, "We can save our planet if we commit to it." And that's just what Chouinard is doing. Emily Ikeda, NBC News.
Thanks.
Unlike people like Mark Zuckerberg and Bill Gates, he does seem more, especially with the things he said, with the things he's done so far, he does seem like more of a person who legitimately cares about these sorts of things than the profit motive. You know?
Welcome back to Squawk Box. It is time for today's Executive Edge. The founders of Patagonia is now giving away his entire company. The apparel maker, started half a century ago, is now worth about $3 billion. The privately held company's stock is now going to be owned by a trust and a group of nonprofit organizations, which will then use all the profits not reinvested into the business to protect the planet. In a letter about his decision, the founder writes in part, "While we're doing our best to address the environmental crisis, it is not enough.
Hi.
We needed to find a way to put more money into fighting the crisis while keeping the company's values intact." Now, he said that one option was to sell the company and donate the money, but the concern there was how a new owner would ultimately act. He goes on to say, quote, "Another path was to take the company public. What a disaster that would have been. Even public companies with good intentions are under too much pressure to create short-term gain at the expense of long-term vitality."
Like, that take is directly what I say. You know what I mean? He's right about that. He nails that. Of course, again, narrow framework, considering that it doesn't revolve around drastically changing the capitalist framework.
And responsibility. Truth be told, he says there were no good options available, so we created our own. This is a story that so many people are talking about. Yep. He effectively said, "I don't need any money anymore."
If he was a real one, he would restructure to give workers ownership. We all know that's the one and not this. Yeah, no, That was the first thing I said. The first thing I said was, if he was legitimately interested in like drastically reshaping society, okay, and fixing the underlying problem, then his number one thing should be to restructure the company in a democratic fashion and then still fucking take all of the, technically you can call it profits still, right, in a democratic fashion and dump it into the 501c4. Do you get it? But in that situation, the workers would have more of a say on where the benefits goes and how much of the profits, like how much of the revenue that is getting put into this fund instead. Okay?
I'm done, which I think unto itself is sort of a fascinating decision. By the way, at one point they went down the road of looking at a SPAC about in terms of how they could raise money and what they were going to ultimately
do
with it.
A better way to keep it pure.
The kids, this to me was so interesting. The kids, his kids, didn't want the company and ultimately didn't want the money. They believe, he says.
And then the workers would just vote to split the pie for themselves. I mean, technically, they're the ones who are creating the value, so it doesn't matter.
Quote, and I think this is true of this family. The kids believe that every billionaire is a policy failure. He said that.
Right.
And it was just so interesting to sort of see him. But look, he's putting his money or his right. money where his mouth is. He's living. You know, we often talk about people who are hypocrites.
Right.
Say one thing, they do something else. They're virtue signaling this or that. This guy is living exactly the way he wants to do.
I want to help.
100% agree with you.
I want to help spend it, and I do. And I want to find. We're going to find some common ground here. So.
You want to help spend his money.
I want to help spend it on. I think that there's a lot that could be done, and I think a lot of issues get really short shrift.
So now you're today. The U.S. government.
No, I want to help him spend it. I think the singular focus on emissions is wrong. I think here's what I would just let's find some common ground here.
Okay.
Water pollution.
Right.
Think of the oceans. Think of our streams. Think of our rivers. I would like every person on this planet to be able to have access to clean water,
right.
where it didn't take 4 hours to get.
Yep.
Air pollution, disgusting air that's not breathable. Do you know how much waste we generate that will take centuries to go away? Both nuclear waste, plastics that are in the ocean, ocean acidification, wildlife conservation, overfishing,
yep.
Deforestation, overpopulation. The resources of the earth are not sustainable.
Right.
I think the singular focus, honestly, and this is where we're going to find common ground. This is a Brett.
You are now the U.S. government.
No. This is a Brett Baer's latest thing is common.
Low-key, like hyper-capitalists completely understand the game. She's right. She's not fucking wrong when she says like, oh, you're now talking about the U.S. government. Yeah. Yeah. Those things should be handled by the government. And the government is a representative of the system that we exist under. So, like, you're right. But that's not going to happen because the government is capitalist.
Common ground. He had Kevin Hassett
and
Jason Furman both right. on at the same time talking about, and they found all this common ground. I'm the biggest environmentalist in the world, but we need to do things that we can actually make a difference on. If India and China continue to emit, if we can...
So here's the thing, bro. Here's the thing. Okay, are you ready? That guy, the fucking Patagonia guy, is working within the narrow framework of capitalism and doing pretty much the best thing you can do while still being a capitalist. And even then, this motherfucker is like, yo, that's not enough. He should be more capitalist. What the fuck?
Continue to chase this singular CO2 obsession. Right. What are any of those not good causes that I did, or things that we need? I mean,
yeah, but
industrial
you can spend
waste.
All your money on that. It's like deciding what somebody else spends.
No, I'm just saying if you're going to try to save the planet, those are some of the things that I think money should be directed towards. The other things. A rush to renewables, which has put us into this mess that we're in right now, a singular focus on stopping hydrocarbon production?
No.
I would just say for somebody to put it up and say while they're living.
Save the planet. What does that mean, though?
Doesn't
save
matter.
The planet.
I'm going to give my money away
right.
to charitable foundations.
No, that's good. But
that's a great thing. And I would say
there's a lot of ways to save the planet
to say,
that don't sure. entail trace levels
sure.
of carbon dioxide. Though,
to me, the larger story is about this guy and this company
oh, okay.
and what they've built. And they've built an extraordinary company. But to me, what's so interesting about it is just that he's decided not only to give the money away, but that he doesn't believe that you can actually run a company in the private sector. I mean, that's right. the other, to me, interesting issue about
it's
this.
The pure idea to not take the SPAC to do it. And
and he does it. Well, but there, by the way, there's people who think, okay, you turn it into a not-for-profit. He's now not going to be involved. Are there incentives? I don't want to say incentives aligned, but if profit is not the motive anymore, does that change things? I mean, I think there's some.
That's so funny. Yeah. Yeah. Profit is not. No, dude. Profit is still the motive. Trust me. If profit was not the motive here, then he would have just fucking turned his company into a cooperative. Okay? if sustainability, like if sustainability within the corporate structure was his main interest there, then yeah, no, it would be a fucking cooperative corporation. Okay? Except that's not the point. He's literally just saying like all profits of the company should just go directly into fucking this 501c4 that will then dump the funds into adequate renewable energy initiatives that I choose, me and my close advisors choose, which of course is the sussy part, but you know, that's just fucking, that's capitalism, baby. It is what it is. It is completely and entirely reliant on whether this guy will be a good person or not. Okay? And that is the unfortunate reality of capitalism. Okay? Just the truth. That's how the system fucking works. Is this just a way to avoid tax for this guy? I mean, if he takes all the money and fucking pockets it again and funds his lifestyle instead of like actually working to, fund renewable energy initiatives and shit like that, then yeah, it is a way to avoid and shelter taxes. Then it's not good. But again, it all hinges on one fucking guy. And there is no control mechanism because the system is not designed to make a rich dude, not be able to. The system is not designed in a way where you can tell a rich guy, hey, you can't spend your money that way. Okay?
Very interesting things. And I would just also suggest once you get into, look, as you know, I believe in all of the environmental issues that you're talking about. I don't think anyone's going to dispute those. But by the way, to get to those,
yeah,
there's lots of things that I would imagine are on the other side of that debate. So the circular economy, you could start to people would effectively regulate Apple and say, you can't make a new phone every year, or your phone has to be disposable,
right.
And then, by the way, other people would turn around and say, well, it's a free market. If they want to make the new phone, they should make the new phone. You shouldn't be able to tell them how to make the new phone. So all this becomes very complicated quickly. Last night.
That was awesome. Here, this guy did do the same thing that Sade did, by the way. But instead of doing it in right before he passes, instead of doing that for the Federalist Society, he's doing it for, again, we don't know what yet. He claims that he's going to do it for conservation efforts. One small difference is that the Chouinards are paying $17.5 million in gift tax on their 2% of shares that are going to a trust outside the C4, but normally a $3 billion gift would result in a $1.2 billion gift tax. By making almost exactly the same move as Sade, the Chouinards are reducing their gift tax liability by 98% and avoiding income tax on any capital gains/dividends from Patagonia that flow into the C4. I happen to share the Chouinards' political views and not Sade's, so in that sense, there is a difference. But it can't be that when liberals avoid gift and income tax by transferring shares to a C4, it's no tax benefit, while when conservatives do the same, it's an unusual series of transactions that appear to have avoided tax liabilities. In one case, it's climate philanthropy. In another, it's dark money. Note that the phrase dark money never appears in the Patagonia story. He's right. That is true about this. It is the same system. The New York Times laying a towel down on the bed for a billionaire Dem who gave 98% of his company to a 501c4 to advance lib causes. Last month, when a billionaire rep gave 100% of his company to a 501c4 to advance conservative causes, the New York Times fretted about dark money. Yeah. It's true, because there is a difference. They're both dark money, technically, but there is a difference between conservation efforts and the fucking Federalist Society. And I personally do think that it is ultimately a good thing, or rather, it is one of the better things you can do within this narrow framework if more billionaires behave this way. However, if he still turns around and uses the 501c4 as his personal slush fund while he's like getting good PR from the likes of New York Times, then that's not good. I hope that this is something that people can understand. wearing Patagucci right now. Where's yours? No. It's labeled as conservation. Yeah, hopefully he isn't shady. Yeah, that's what I'm not saying is fucking fire. Like, you know, we should worship the altar of this billionaire. Like, of course not. But he does seem like the type of dude who's like, yeah, I don't give a fuck about it. I just like climbing and I want to protect the environment. At least like the Patagonia actions leading up to this very moment have been pretty hyper-focused on sustainability, not as an effort to just simply greenwash, but genuinely going above and beyond to ensure sustainability. Because it does seem like it's just something he cares about. You get it? You understand? That's my take. We should cross our fucking fingers and pray absolutely powerless in the face of this amount of money. Yeah. That Jarvis guy is a legit Nazi that you've banned 20 times? Wait, which one? Oh, this guy? Oh, the Jarvis guy who's tweeting. Oh, yeah. The guy's an old school rock climber and an old school climbing culture is very anti-materialist and idolized just being a dirtbag, travel line, climbing. Climbing, being very frugal and only work occasionally to fund climbing. This guy's hopefully good, but most billionaires don't come from that background and we shouldn't rely on them for this shit. Yes. I agree. Anyway, that's my take on the Patagonia shit. Sorry that it's not as exciting and not as like enthusiastic about him, but also not as immediately like shitting on him in the way that you wanted me to cover this. Like, because I feel as though people only want to hear me either like directly shit and say that we should kill every billionaire or whatever, or say something along the lines of like, oh man, this guy's actually really fucking good. I love him, but the world is more complicated than that, and there's more nuance necessary in this situation, in this kind of analysis.
Joe, Nancy, and Chuck threw a party to celebrate the economy while the Dow collapsed and Americans got poor.
I'll be there in a second. I gotta pee.
It was a full-on fiesta. It had a hype man, it had music, and even some gibberish from the president. Listen.
I have seen fire, and I've seen rain.
Is New York in the house?
Are there any Californians in the house?
Think about what you'd think about at the time. Think about how you'd feel.
I don't know what that all was, but what were the Republicans doing? On the day inflation roared back and the market crashed, I thought I'd see Republican senators holding press conferences in front of grocery stores and gas stations, you know, promising to bring prices down if you put them back in charge. But that's not what happened. Instead, Lindsey Graham called a press conference to propose a nationwide abortion ban.
We should have a law at the federal level that would say after 15 weeks, no abortion on demand, except in cases of rape, incest, to save the life of the mother.
Senator Lindsey Graham joins me now. So, Senator Graham, Republicans are very angry at you. You're getting a lot coming for this. Yeah. Why'd you do it on that day? Not great timing. Don't you see that?
I'm proudly pro-life, and I have no apology for being pro-life, and there's no bad time to defend the unborn. So if you expect me to sit on the sidelines and watch the Democratic Party try to pass the most radical abortion law in the history of the country, you're talking to the wrong guy. What do I oppose? Schumer and Pelosi have proposed a law for the entire nation that will allow abortion on demand until the point of birth. There are seven nations on the...
Love this. Lindsey Graham straight up came out of the gates fucking swinging, saying, hey, we fucked up. We're just going to go back and we're going to decide. Abortion is no longer murder, guys. Congratulations. The Republican Party has decided that abortion is no longer murder. It's like light murder. It's murder only after 15 weeks. Which is pretty fire of them. Pretty cool of them to come to that conclusion. Okay. It's like diet murder. It's murder light. It's also not states' rights. It's states' wrongs. I mean, you're literally going against every fucking thing that you have said as a talking point for the past however many fucking years that you've been advocating. Sorry. It's just so dumb. It's just so silly. And guess what? People are not very happy about this. Turns out they're not very happy.
The planet have that extreme view. China and North Korea are two of the
seven. We all agree on that. Well,
no, wait a minute. Now, listen. I'm not going to sit on the sidelines and let America become that kind of nation.
No one's saying you need to sit on the sidelines, but yesterday was...
Bro, this is so funny. It's just, they have absolutely zero fucking principles, dude. There is nothing. There is no better representation. No better representation whatso-fucking-ever. Okay? That these motherfuckers do not care about anything. These motherfuckers do not care about anything than what Hold on, I'm gonna give my phone to Marat real quick.
Wasn't the day to do that. Yesterday was the day they lost all momentum when this inflation thing punched them right in the face. Hold on. And you gave him an out. A lot of people don't like that. You could have done it on any other day. Yeah. Just like you could have delayed the whole press conference, like Joe should have delayed that stupid party.
So I take issue. I don't think there's a bad day to stand up for the unborn. What am I trying to say? That America needs to have a policy that makes us a civilized nation. It would bother me that if a baby's aborted at 38 weeks in California, New York, what am I proposing for our country? That at 15 weeks, when the baby can feel pain, you provide anesthesia to save its life. If you operate on it, it should be protected from being dismembered by an abortionist. That puts us in line with France, Germany, Great Britain. They all have abortion bans.
All of a sudden, these guys want to be like European pussies on abortion, which is rather odd, you know, rather strange. Where'd that come from?
Bans below 15.
I understand. So, and the people are with you on that. No, you're right.
I'm not going to apologize.
You're right. No.
Ever apologize about standing up for the unborn. And you know what? We need to go on the offensive here.
It's not what's in your heart. Americans agree with that. They're against abortion after the first trimester. But
Wait, they are? I thought they were just against abortion, which is murder. That's so strange. When did that happen? Wait. I thought Americans were all just anti-murder, which was what abortion was. Wait a minute. What's going on right now? Why is Jesse Waters saying that? That's so strange. And guess what? The Republican Party is not. aligned on these values, turns out. Mitch McConnell said, hey, we should still leave it up to the states. I think Lindsey's going crazy. So much so that New York Times, which normally loves, and I mean fucking loves, when Republicans come out and you know, make a good moderate policy, even the New York Times themselves wrote some scathing remarks on this this wishy-washy, flip-flopping bullshit from the Republican Party that has been cutting propaganda, saying that all abortions are murder up until, you know, they started actually acting out on that, you know, political motivation. And now that, like, they're forcing fucking 15-year-old rape victims to go and you know, carry pregnancies to term and shit, and that blew up in their fucking faces, that Americans are like, what the fuck are you guys doing? You're out of your mind. They're like, oh, yeah, we just meant, like, it's not, it's light murder. It's actually light murder.
There, you got to talk tactics, Senator. It's terrible timing, terrible tactics. We could have shoved this down their throat on the day the Americans got hammered with this inflation number and the market crashing. And now all the media and the Democrats are talking about federal abortion ban. You know that's not smart.
He's mad because, and he's, I can't believe I'm saying this, Jesse Waters is right. But also, so is Lindsey Graham. Because Lindsey Graham is trying to make a political calculation here to flip the narrative away, to like put Democrats on the back foot and get them to concede on like the most popular point of abortion, which is like where 90% of abortions happen anyway, the first trimester. Okay, and get them to fight, get Democrats to say like, no, we want late term abortions or whatever the fuck. Okay?
I have regular appointments. I did everything I'm right. And at 16 weeks, we found out that our son was likely not live. When he was born, he lived for 8 days.
Yeah.
He bled from every orifice of his body, but we were allowed to make that choice for him.
Yes, ma'am.
Here's what I would say. The world pretty much has spoken on this issue. The developed world has said at this stage into the pregnancy, the child feels pain. And we're saying we're going to join the rest of the world and not be like Iran. As to your particular case, there'll be exceptions for life of the mother and rape and incest. But
there are
exceptions in this bill. Well, ma'am, this there are 55,000 abortions after the 15-week period, and I think we're resolved to get America back in line with the rest of the world, and we won't know where America is until we vote, until we debate. And so to my Democratic friends, you're going around calling all of us every name you can think of. We're a bunch of wackos.
I mean, it is true. You are a bunch of wackos. You're doing whack shit. You got no response to that, brother, do you?
Your idea is wacko, not ours. Let's vote. Give me a chance to vote on this bill.
That's so funny. What a hilarious way to just like go against everything that the Republican Party's campaigned on for the past like 30 fucking years, dude. Yeah, and then he thinks it's such a sly way to like also tailor this like as a ban, a federal ban on abortions, and not a federal protection on abortions up to the first trimester, and then the rest of it the states decide. He's literally trying to do a reverse Roe v. Wade, right? Where he's saying, we'll offer protections up to 15, okay, first trimester, and then everything else, states can actually decide. They're not allowed to decide. Which, originally, if that was like their fucking, if that's what if the Republican Party ran on that originally, yeah, that would have made some sense, but that's not what they ran on, is it?
We'll take her considerations and we'll vote. Now, I guarantee if we have a debate on the floor of the United States Senate where we can explain what we're doing versus what they would do, we'll do really well with the American people. And over time, God willing, we're going to be like the rest of the world and not like Iran at the federal level when it comes to abortion. We're going nowhere. Thank you very
much. Yeah, not like Iran. Iran and China, they let you do abortions all the way up to when the baby's coming out. That's what they're. That's a really good talking point, man. That's pretty sick. Thanks. I'm sure people give a fuck about that.
Well, politics, right?
They're lying. Here's what I would say. I know everybody knows inflation's out of control. This is the most extreme agenda for the American people on the border when it comes to crime. And let me just say this. It is now time for the pro-life community to lend their voice to the most extreme measures being pushed by the Democratic Party. We should have done it yesterday. We should have done it the day before. But from this day forward, I promise you to prosecute the case against their border policies, against their economic policies, against their foreign policy. But I will not make any apology to you or anybody else for standing up against the most radical agenda.
I'm not asking for an apology. I'm just saying you're getting a lot of heat for the timing of that.
I can stand the heat.
I know, yeah, but the wedge issue is partial birth abortion. The wedge issue is partial birth. That's what it is.
You know what the issue is? That most Americans would be disgusted with a policy that allows the dismemberment of a baby at 15 weeks.
I agree.
The people are with me. And if I'm not willing to talk up now, if not now, when? If not me, who? So I agree with you on the economic policies, but my friend— the pro-life community needs to speak up, and we will, and we will win this issue because we're right.
All right. I respect your opinion.
Thank
you. Like I said, timing was off, and timing is everything, Senator. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming
in. Tell that to the baby.
Yeah, just like at the top of the hour, timing is everything, where I serve you with a 60-second ad break. And if you no longer want to see those ads, well, then all you need to do is subscribe, which you can do for $5 or for free with the Twitch Prime. Okay. That's right. Timing is everything. Tell that to the baby, he says. Well, tell that to the baby, you chatters. Like I said, you no longer want to see them ads. All you need to do is subscribe, baby. You can also get gifted a sub if you're lucky. Here's the 1 minute ad break now. La 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 Keisha, thank you for the five gifted subs. Here's the 1 minute ad break now. Isn't Graham wants to make abortions federally protected for 15 weeks and the states decide after that? No, it's the opposite. He wants to protect abortions for 15 weeks and then states are not allowed to. But red states, if they want to, they can. I think the way he wants to do it is like, no. He wants to do it so that like abortion is protected up to 15 weeks, but states are not allowed to go beyond 15 weeks. That's why I said it's like the reverse Roe v. Wade. Roe v. Wade protects states, like stops states from making more restrictive abortion laws that criminalize abortion at any capacity, like the ones we've seen so far. He wants it to be 15 weeks max. States can go less than 15 weeks, but they can't go higher than 15 weeks. The fuck? This guy is crazy. He said, mad at X, then leave early? What the fuck is this guy talking about? What? Is he on? Are you on mobile, bro? I went to the event. I don't know if you know that or not, but. The fuck? Motherfucker came in with a Motorola Razr. Like, shit camp was 2 weeks ago at this point.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello. My name is Kirsten. It's very nice to meet you guys.
Eight women choose who he dates, but it didn't work out, so... Oh, shit.
If you would swipe right, as in yes, I want you to stay standing. If you would swipe left, as in no, I want you to exit the stage. 1, 2, 3
Nice. Who's gonna do the honors? Yeah, we gotta start with that.
Hey, okay.
Where are you from, Chris?
I'm from San Diego.
San Diego.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you do?
I'm a student, so I'm a senior at UCSD.
Bro, she is the most San Diego looking Kristen I've ever seen in my life, dude. It's like I've never seen a more San Diego woman in my entire... Bro, this is literally like she is the perfect representation of a blonde Kristen from San Diego. It is crazy.
Cool. And I also work a lot. I serve at two different restaurants. I work 7 days a week, so but honestly, I really like working. And
what are you majoring in school?
Environmental science, nice. And I'm minoring in econ.
What do you like to do for fun?
What? Okay. I just kind of tried starting surfing.
I watched a ton of pornos that start just like this. What we doing here, man? I can't even say wrong. I can't even say I don't agree with that. I'm going to be honest. Yeah, it does. It does. It is giving porn, okay? It is.
Surfing. This last year, I've really tried to like pick up new hobbies. I find the time because I want to find the time. I don't sit around at home. I take every hour of the day that I can to be... Wait a minute.
You want some?
Why not? Thank you, bro.
Just let me know when.
That's perfect.
Oh, dang, you just broed me?
No, she's a nice dude.
It's like a respectful bro. You know what I mean? But yeah, that's basically my life every day. I go to the gym almost every day. That's a big activity of mine. Hiding the gains under the outfit.
What kind of car do you drive?
Now I have a nice little Honda Civic.
Oh,
nice. Actually, it is nice. No, it's really...
Yeah, I got that wrong. I would have thought she had a Jeep. You know what I mean? She looks like a Jeep girl.
Not bad. I'm a big like music fan, so the volume is very loud in my
what's
car.
What's your genre? Yeah, wait, what's your genre?
My favorite artist is Black Bear.
Oh my
I'm
god,
really
mine
into
too.
Black Bear.
You like country Black music? Bear, I
think. No.
Yeah.
What? Bro. If it were up to me, I'd make that sentence illegal. My favorite artist is Black Bear is a sentence that I would make illegal. Okay.
It's actually really funny because my roommate is super into country music. Down in PV, there's like a bunch of bars in Pacific Beach, we're always fighting about the spots there because there's like a big country bar over
that's
there.
That's a real argument, though.
Now, I have a funny story for like one time I was in PV. I was so drunk, I gave him like my debit card instead of my ID.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
But then I gave my ID. I was like, okay.
So have you had any crazy like party experiences?
That was a terrible story, man. Brother, you're not making it past the first round, homie. That was a terrible... What the fuck? That... Oh, no. Oh, no, dude. That was not good, my friend. Oh, no, dude.
I would say I was actually pretty reserved for a long time. I really kind of stuck to my guns. So I actually don't have too many crazy stories yet, but I've really tried to pack it in.
He's the hottest one there, though. Okay, say you just like tall men and go. He's literally just the tallest guy there. That's it. You just said he's the hottest one there because he's the tallest one there. That's it.
Red flag.
I actually said this in the other video, isn't it, too? But commitment issues are definitely a big deal for me.
Okay. I'm not like... I'm going to be honest. Like, I don't know if I'm... I don't know if this is feminism or whatever, but I do feel like... the... ladies had at least more personality when we watched the other way around. the dudes unironically do seem like just, they seem kind of boring. They're like, yeah, oh, I love Black Bear too. what the fuck?
Like, oh, you were, I saw that in a video.
Hey! I kind of want to know what everyone's red flag is.
Definitely commitment issues.
I saw that video and I was like, do I have commitment issues?
For your dating history, like, what do you, like, what's normally your type?
Like, I just, in general, really like someone who's also outgoing. I actually am very outgoing myself, and I like someone to be even more outgoing than that. So that's like a big thing for me.
The bar is high.
Yes, yeah.
Like
exactly.
Like adventurous, like, hey, let's go to this place right now. Let's go. Let's
right,
go, let's
like
go.
Someone's gotta lead the pack, and I feel like I do that a lot myself, so it's cool to have someone else do that for once. And I don't know, in terms of like physicality, I think I just like handsome men. I think that's my type. Handsome men.
You have nine handsome men?
Hey, bro, you got no game, bro.
Oh, no!
I was cringing for you, bro. I was like,
wait, who?
Yoo-hoo! Yeah, yoo-hoo!
Oh, no, he's right, though. He's right. He's right, dude. You ain't got no game, dude. What the fuck?
It was going good until you did the ID story, and we were like, oh.
Okay, who actually?
Oh my God, he just straight up said, bro, just don't open your mouth. He said, don't open your mouth. And you're good. Like, you were in the game, but then you opened your mouth and you fucked it up.
He felt like they, like, really related to her and, like, really liked her and, like, would want to go on to the next round. Let's just make sure that, like, people are in.
Okay, I do.
Like for me, I just didn't feel like I like related to her on some levels. Cause like I'm like
I think your music taste. I was
yeah
like,
yeah no like I that like so that's the thing though like I'm an art student so like I can only relate on like
know,
music and
like
movies
Black
and stuff.
Bear,
we didn't
though.
Talk about
he
that. Like,
what about you guys?
But at the same time, I think it was like too quick too late to say like I can't relate to that person or not. I for sure.
Bro, he is Santiago's popping off. Okay, I mean he's OP. He's goated. He's got an accent. Getting real, you know, he's active, okay? He's getting involved in the conversations, like, he's just...
I want to know her better, like continue to talk, yeah.
They're gonna kick the tall guy out. Smart. Oh, he, what the fuck? Voted for himself?
Kirsten, how you doing?
Good.
I'm
very
Dave.
Clammy hands, just so you know.
Oh, you got clammy hands? I thought you were talking about mine.
No.
Dang.
You get the clammy hand too.
Yeah,
hello.
I got it too.
Nice to meet you.
Again?
Officially, yeah. I don't think I told you my name. I'm Brandon.
Brandon, okay, cool.
Pleasure to meet you.
I feel like this is also the perfect time to make a clarification.
Yeah.
Very common misconception. My name is Kirsten.
Kirsten, okay. Did I pronounce it wrong the first time?
I don't know, but usually
Kirsten.
They
Kirsten.
Do.
Cool,
so
cool, cool.
I just all like right. to put it out there.
It's now coming. I know, then we're good.
Yeah, now we're cool.
Before we weren't cool?
No. Right. You got bro'd, remember?
Oh, I did get bro'd. Yeah. She did bro me, I forgot, yeah.
Thank you so much for taking time out your busy week to come
of
see
course.
Us.
Of course, anytime.
Work 7 days a week.
Bro, what is happening right now? Are we all like this? Men, what are we doing? Are we actually all like this? Why are we so bad? What the fuck's happening? That's the guy who had game? He's like, oh, yeah, were we doing good before? Oh, no, you did bro me. What the fuck? Yo, how the fuck do we ever get pussy? This is crazy, dude. What a... Yo, much like capitalism, society... On the other hand, unironically does rely on women being magnanimous enough to give us any kind of pussy whatsoever. If this is the game that we're kicking, what the fuck is happening, dude? Is it pity pussy? Is that the only way we get laid? What the fuck? What the fuck is happening here?
This is one of those 7 days, so
It's very true. Yeah. I had to switch shifts for this. It's very important.
I really don't understand how you seem like you have like a lot of things going on all the time. I don't know how you balance
it. I just never stop. I'm at my house for like maybe 30 minutes in the middle of the day to like change for work.
Ew. That's really admirable. Like I respect that a lot. I wish I had much more of like the drive in me to do that. Like I love going back home and just being on my bed. I'm like, oh, this is like so, like it's like a chill time. I don't know.
Do you have a job?
Right now, no.
Actually, recently I just went full-time artist. So as of now, I don't have a job. I'm also a full-time student. So I go to school in Long Beach for psychology, so. Yeah.
So you're from San Diego, you said?
I am, born and raised, I've lived there my whole life.
That's awesome.
How about you? I love
Indiana.
Oh, wow.
So not even close,
Yeah,
so I'm from San Diego as well.
What part?
Like Vista, Carlsbad area.
I'm from Argentina, that's why I had this
Sounds
accent.
Like it, yeah.
Oh, okay. I've been here for 2 months, so you say like you spend time in the ocean, so that's cool. I've been getting surf here, so that's, I don't know, have you surfed here in LA?
I have not in LA I don't know how it is up here. I don't think
it's as great as San Diego, to be honest.
But I think San Diego's got some killer surf, so I agree.
Yeah, and the water is clean, like super clean.
What's your dream job? It can include environmental science, but like really just what you would want to do in general. Yeah.
I do really like politics, which is kind of like random, but I really like public.
Sorry, I said the Kirsten thing, okay? If you're a Hassan Abi head, I'm sorry I said that. You have a lot more game than these dudes do, okay?
Public speaking, like that's a good asset to have for that kind of job.
Definitely.
I could see myself in government or in politics and kind of using that environmental background to sort of inform.
That's a great answer for one, because our generation needs to get more into politics so that we can get people in our generation into these positions sooner.
Yeah.
So like what's the most impulsive thing you've ever done then?
Yeah, I always consider myself to be very impulsive. Like I'll just do whatever. Someone invites me to something, I'll go. Mm-hmm. Someone wants to do anything, like I'll just do it.
Blonde hair white girl in LA is a Republican? Dude, you're crazy.
No, it's all.
Why do you think conservatives fucking chirp nonstop about women in colleges and shit? 90% of the young conservative rhetoric revolves around never getting laid because every fucking college girl, regardless of what their background is, like 98% of them are like fucking either liberal or rad lib or just straight leftist. It's unironically a big part of what makes more young conservatives and incels. They're like, aha, I hate that.
Always yes.
I like that. So yeah, I did the same thing. So I had like an impulsive like tattoo moment. So I actually got a yes tattoo.
Oh my God.
So it's like, saying yes to new opportunities, like getting out.
Chad and Santiago are the only two kicking game right now.
Out of your
a little bit.
Zone and just like kind of going for it. So
have you ever been to South America?
I've been to Costa Rica.
Costa Rica?
But
nice.
But I absolutely loved it there. It's been my favorite place I've ever traveled.
I want to go to Costa Rica so bad, like so bad. They have the best waves over there.
Where am I going to take you out for our first date? What do you like to eat?
It's forward. I really like Italian food and Mexican food, but it's kind of interesting because I do consider myself very adventurous, but the one thing I am not adventurous in is food. Like simple foods, that is what I'm eating. It is bean and cheese burrito. Yeah, I'll take a cheese pizza.
Bean and cheese burrito?
Uh-huh.
But you like Italian food, so like Italian
food. I do like Italian food, right?
Layla's good looking.
I work at an Italian bakery and I'm a baker there, so I do the
Someone with a job.
She likes that. She likes that. He's good looking and he's a baker.
The pizzas.
How you feel about nightlife? I mean, you have been to Europe. Party.
Santiago, please do not fuck this up. Don't talk about how you're a fuck boy.
It's in Argentina, usually like we go to the nightclub at 2 a.m.
Yeah.
And we party that until like 6, and then we may go to another party afterward. Yeah, we party hard in Argentina. But here I go to the venue or the place like 9. I'm out in my bed like at 3.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I can't imagine being out later than 2 in the morning.
One of my biggest things, like honesty. So like, I just want to be honest.
This dude is good looking as hell too, but he's too nerdy.
I almost voted myself off just because like, I didn't talk much in that first round. And I did hear what you were saying about like wanting somebody who's more outgoing than you.
Yeah.
But he's definitely Twitch watcher, likes anime. He's just coming across as nerdy.
And honestly, I don't know if I am. You know, when you get more comfortable with somebody, I do get more outgoing. Right. But like, I'm a little bit more shy at first, but even now I feel more comfortable. Like,
yeah, I mean, I think either way, putting yourself out there, just coming here at all and speaking at all is a big deal. Yeah. Especially for someone who maybe
socks, I haven't looked yet.
Yeah, I would say I am, but like once I get like more comfortable, then I'm like, you're gonna be like, dude, you're annoying. Like, please, like, leave me alone, leave me alone. Like, I'm done with you.
Wow, that's aggressive. Make sure you don't end on something like that.
No, but like, I'm fun too. Like, I like to go out. I like
the
hiking.
Yeah, give me a promotion. Like, promote yourself for 20 seconds.
Trilingual. I can speak 3 different languages, French, Italian, and English.
That's cool.
So I'm really outgoing as well.
Okay.
It's sometimes hard because of the English, like, to communicate around.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, I mean.
Yeah, but he makes up for it by being Argentinian. I mean, dude, so active, dude. So active. Every fucking foreign exchange student, every like foreign student in college from, you know, Argentina or anywhere really, like any Spanish speaking country in general is like this. I swear to God.
I don't know, I just go in adventures, like I'm like down for a plan whenever they say, Santi, let's go, yeah. I'm going, I'm 100% in.
Yes, always yes.
Always yes, but it's good to say no sometimes as well. No. So you gotta find the balance.
Yeah, well.
Later. Now you're good, I'll talk to you in a minute.
Yeah, sounds good.
Yeah,
that was sweet. Thank very you. Nice.
Hey, these two guys got clapped, let's be real.
Zach, nice to meet you.
You too.
Have a nice one, Kirsten.
You too, thank you.
I'm not gonna lie, I don't think anybody should vote for me. I have friends that are picky eaters and that stuff low-key makes me mad. A little bit. Like beans and cheese, cool, it tastes good, but like you're missing out on a lot, I feel like. Personally, I think Leo and Santi, I was thinking, but so I'm gonna make my decision up there, but I feel like Santi was providing some like unknown.
When she started talking to Santi, like, her whole body posture changed. She put her leg up on the chair. She crossed her arms. She was like.
I think him and Leo fucking popped off. Maybe Chad, but definitely him and Leo the most. Wait, who the fuck gave a heart to JC?
Pretty good. I'm excited.
Do we trust these men?
No. Never trust men.
Walter, are you ready to meet who the boys thought was your best match?
Sure am.
All right, on three.
They're hearting guys. Kind of sus. Yeah, bro, fellas, is it gay to heart other men?
One, two, three.
Hey. Long time.
Long time no see.
Yeah, exactly. Well, nice to see you behind the curtain.
Yeah,
and in front of the curtain.
Yeah.
How are you feeling?
Pretty good.
How do you
excited.
Feel?
Yeah. I'm. It's like.
I think I don't know if she picked him. She might have picked Lael.
Cool to have been on both ends of this as well. Okay, so my picks after the first round were Daniel, Santiago.
Oh my God.
And Lael.
Oh my God, bro. She picked Daniel because he's tall. Incels were right. Short cells were right, bro. I swear to God, the tall advantage is so aggressive. That's so OP. OP stats, boys. OP fucking stats. Oh my God.
And then my pick this round, Santiago.
Hey! You say that?
Yes, very well. See, look at that. Maybe I should trust you guys. I think it's adventure time. That's what I've heard in a lot of conversation.
I'm down to go to San Diego.
Oh,
to,
yeah.
For a first aid.
Very nice. Yeah.
Tall needs to be nerfed on the next patch. Yeah, bro. You know what's nerfing tall? Capitalism. Everything is made for, like, smaller people. She's been on Fox News, by the way. What? Just made that up, dude. She literally is too young to have ever been on the O'Reilly Factor. Stop saying I knew it. That's fake. She would have had to have been like 12. If I was God King of the world, you Talls would be the first to go. Really?
Come on down. I'll be there.
Why the fuck, dude? Listen, I'm an ally. I'm an ally. I'm an ally. I'm an ally. I'm an ally to the short and the bald. I'm an ally to the short and the bald. Hello. Wee woo. Excuse me. I am an ally to the short and the bald. Okay? It's fucked up.